policy in Carnegie Hall is a good one. If your cell phone goes off during the performance, you will be asked to do a solo.
It's Carnegie Hall.
Yes. No, here. You'll do it here. So for anyone who doesn't know me, I'm Diane Sayre, and I was just talking with Everett here because it was almost exactly a year ago that we began this process of creating a Schiller Institute community chorus. And I had wanted to do a Messiah sing-along, and my collaborator and Schiller Institute representative Dennis Speed, who's sitting right there, had the idea that in the wake of what had happened in Ferguson, Missouri, and the Eric Garner ruling here in New York, that shouldn't we do something that could unite the people of Manhattan in a more elevated way? Because what you're getting in the media all the time is rage and fear and rage and rage and fear. And really, it was very clear from the family of Garner and other New Yorkers that people did not want violence. They did not want the division. And we decided to do a sing-along of Handel's Messiah at the Verdi Tuning, which we did at All Souls Unitarian Church. And Everett was our soloist, one of the soloists of the first performance. And then we organized the community chorus, which has grown, and for people who've seen us, it's about 40 members on average, and it would be 65 or 70 members if everybody would show up who's supposed to.
Hint, hint.
Yes, hint, hint. So I just wanted to say a couple things. We are celebrating the life and work of Franz Schubert, whose death was on November 19th, 1828. And he was only 31 years old when he died. And I think John and others may have more to say about his life and his career, but as everyone might imagine, when you are fighting for beauty, when you're fighting for a certain quality of dignity and nobility of humankind, you generally find yourself being up against popular culture and popular opinion. And many people who were engaged in such battles had very short lives, and I don't think for accidental reasons, because if you have the outlook of Zeus, of oligarchy or empire, the last thing you want is for human beings to be creative. It makes it very hard to enslave them. And that is the principle to which the Schiller Institute, founded by Helga Zeph LaRouche, the wife of Lyndon LaRouche, is dedicated, that it is through beauty that one proceeds to freedom. So tonight we will be hearing all works of Schubert. And first will be Michelle Fuchs. Michelle, stand up. For anyone who doesn't know Michelle, performances of the Messiah on the harpsichord that was generously donated. spends his time between Virginia and Manhattan, hopefully more time in Manhattan. We have Everett Suttle, who I mentioned. Everett Suttle is who has sung all over the world, including at La Scala, including in Russian and all kinds of other things. And he was one of the original soloists at the first Messiah that we did after the Garner ruling. And then finally, John Sigerson. Our chorus and the two performances of the Messiah. So two other things. This is our own piano. It is tuned at the Verdi tuning, which is A at about 432, middle C at 256 cycles. It's very important, and you may notice a certain wonderful quality of the voices in this music because of that. We are making a last call for anyone who is not in the chorus. You are welcome to join. And if you've sung the Messiah before, it's very helpful. If not, or if you have or have not, you should see me or Michelle at the end of this and give us your email. We will send you the practice recording so you can prepare. We are having a major rehearsal here in this room, actually at this time a week from now. We normally practice on Thursday nights, but since Thursday is Thanksgiving and I did not want to cook for people, what we decided is that we would have our rehearsal on Saturday from 6:30 to 8:30. So 1 week from today, 6:30 to 8:30, we will be rehearsing here, and I would expect all of you to be here for that. So with that being said, one last check. Anyone who came in newly or has not checked your cell phone, make sure it's turned off, and we will begin.
Okay, and a slight clarification. The reason that it is challenging to work with Diane is not because she's difficult to work with. She's fine to work with. But every time you think that you have figured out how to do all the things that we're doing, she finds that we're going to do something else. We're going to do another concert. We're going to recruit all of Manhattan to this chorus. That's why. So she's a very, very good chorus.
Thank you. Before we start the Spanengesang, I want to say a few words about it and its significance. As Diane was saying, this is we thought about this because Franz Schubert joined the Angels 187 years ago last Thursday. This swan song, or Spanengesang, was his swan song indeed. These were pieces that were assembled by his friends and publisher shortly after his death. And it consists of really two cycles, not just one. That's why we divided it up with a break in between. Because the first cycle is a cycle of poems by a very well-known pianist, music critic, and poet, Ludwig Rellstab. Then the second second set is by an even greater, or even better known poet, Heinrich Heine. And these were, probably Schubert intended both of these as separate song cycles. But he didn't complete them, and as a matter of fact, there are a few other songs by Ludwig Rellstab that didn't make it into the Spanengesang, but we're not going to sing those. And then the final song is not by either of those, but it was included by the publisher because it's considered to be the last song that Schubert ever composed. I want to say something about Spanengesang and the idea, because I don't know if you've ever thought about it, but what is a swan? Probably you've heard the term swan song. You know that it's something about a swan singing when it's dying. At least that comes from Greek mythology. There are many discussions of this idea of a swan singing a beautiful song, even though for most of its life it's completely silent. However, there's been a lot of controversy around this because if you look around today, if you kill a swan, or if Swan dies, it rarely does sing that song. Although, or sing much of a song, they sort of squawk. But there are, what I found is that there are actually some species of swans that do that. And there was a report in 1899 by a naturalist who said that the trumpeter swan, a rather rare species of swan, quote, sounded as it was shot and it was, you know, swooping down to its death. It, quote, sounded at times like the soft running of the notes of an octave. So there is something to it, but there's a lot even more to it. I want to read you a little poem that was written to which a madrigal was written in 1612. It's an English composer, Orlando Gibbons. And you may have heard this madrigal. It's a beautiful madrigal. It's called The Silver Swan. And the words are beautiful, but also they bear on some things that I'm going to say in a bit. I'll read it to you. The silver swan, who, living, had no note, when death approached, unlocked her silent throat. Leaning her breast upon the reedy shore, thus sang her first and last, and sang no more. Farewell, all joys, O death, come close mine eyes. More geese than swans now live, more fools than wise. Well, that indeed, I think, is the significance of this swan song, because this was a swan song not just of Schubert himself, but of a whole generation and of a whole concept which was dying. At the point, right around the point that Schubert died. Diane mentioned this about the people, the various people who also died, many of them very young. But and the list is really quite amazing. I just wanted to read you a couple of, just to give you an idea. Karl Maria von Weber, I don't know if you've ever heard of him, he's a very famous composer, and he wrote probably the Freischütz you probably heard, but also there's an opera Oberon. And I might mention that the overtures and also the whole opera of this was one of the favorite pieces that was performed by Wilhelm Furtwängler quite often. He died on June 5th, 1826, at the age of 39, of tuberculosis. That was 1826. The following year, March 26th, 1827, Beethoven died. He was 56. Then, in the same year, later on September September 30th, 1827, Wilhelm Müller died of a heart attack. Wilhelm Müller was the poet of the two great Schubert song cycles, the Schöne Müllerin and the Winterreise. And he was a very close friend of Heinrich Heine, and who looked up to him. He was somewhat older than Heine. Schubert, he was really one of the greatest poets, whose poems made fun of the whole Romantic movement. Was poking fun at this growing idea of Romanticism. There are aspects of Romanticism which are useful to think about, but this was the current which really said that music is not about ideas, it's just about feelings. And it was beginning to create a separation between ideas and feelings, and also a depth separation between science and art. To create that, something which then was pushed throughout the 19th century through the current that ended up with people like Bertrand Russell, who said that mathematics is everything, and that people and creative thought is nothing. So that was then. Then Schubert himself died in November 19th, on November 19th, 1828, at the age of 31. And right around that time, it's very interesting, there was an election campaign in the United States. The election campaign was going on from October 31st to December 2nd, 1828. And this is the election campaign where one of America's greatest presidents, John Quincy Adams, was defeated by this total traitor, Andrew Jackson. So that was a turning point there in American history as well. And at the same time, it was a turning point in European history. Things really, really got very bad for Germany and for all of Europe. And frankly, it really didn't recover very much until 40 or 50 years later with the rise of Bismarck, where Germany was unified and where there was a push for a revival of culture based on an alliance between Germany and Russia. And I think it's interesting to think about today, because the absolute necessity for us, the United States now, to have an alliance with Russia and with China, if humanity is to survive over the next period. And that was all ended in 1890 from the very unfortunate dismissal of Bismarck, and the drift, I would say rather quick drift, of the ruling German family into the British imperial order with the rise of Kaiser Wilhelm II. But back to that, I also just pointed out that around the same time of Schubert's death and so forth, it's interesting to note that in 1831 and 32 was the first major cholera epidemic that swept through Europe and also took away even more lives of creative individuals. So it was a very bad period, but at the same time, I think that and obviously there were people who were in ones and twos and small groups were continuing on with this tradition, Mendelssohn, Schubert, Schumann, of course, and Brahms, and both Schumanns, Clara and Robert. But I think that's really what I want to say about this right now. So I think that what we should do... Oh, just one other point I want to make about the Swan Song. What came to mind, this idea of the geese and the swans, also what other and separating them and making sure that the that we today have that we make sure that we have more wise than fools is a little quote from the Requiem Mass. Inter oves locum presta et apedis me sequestra statuens in parte dextra, which means, please put me among the sheep and separate me from the goats. So that I may stand at the right hand of God. And with that, I would like to now side with the sheep and with the swans, and let's sing. Entire first half of the cycle and so forth, just in order for you to concentrate. These songs are very challenging. If you've never heard them before and you can't follow it, don't worry, you'll be hearing them again.
You forgot to introduce Franzi.
Oh, I'm sorry, you introduced Franzi.
This is Franzi. She is joining us from Vienna, all the way from Vienna. Thank you.
Und ihre Rosen in Purpur. as famed as who's insane and can and leave a schmerz, can and leave a schmerz.
Thank you. Thank you. Two.
Thank you.
das Unglück selge weib, vergiftet mit ihren
last song Schubert wrote. He died penniless, alone. But you see it, and you will see it's not a sad song, it's a happy song. So I think that's very telling of who he was. How old was Schubert, Maestro? 31 years old. Sehr jung.
Thank you.
tonight, come join the choir.